Post-secondary institutions in our province have until December to put rules in place protecting the right to have controversial speakers on campus. The Alberta government is asking colleges and universities enact rules that would ensure speakers can share their points of view without fear of being censored. Alberta's advanced education minister says the policies will ensure post-secondary institutions remain open to debate, while critics say it could cause some to question an institution's credibility.
To engage in philosophical debate, critical thinking, academic discovery, and of course that can't happen without strong protections around free speech.
Why should ideas that have been delegitimized be then given legitimacy in the university? Anti-vaxxing is not something that is grounded in science, and so we don't need the university to give a platform to those kinds of ideas.
Ontario has put similar protections in place under Premier Doug Ford. And Danielle Smith from 770CHQR joins us this morning to continue the conversation on this story. And Danielle, you're going to talk to the minister about this today.
I am. I'm sort of surprised that he's delaying it. I wouldn't have thought that this was going to be such a difficult topic and such a difficult process for the universities to go through to secure free speech. I mean, free speech kind of began on university campuses. That's what they're known for, is being able to have challenging ideas. It's essentially what their purpose is. I find it interesting that, you know, if you get into a situation where you want to pick and choose which ideas are delegitimized and which ones aren't, you end up with a real problem. Take, for example, the person you just quoted there on the anti-vaxxing issue. If you're not prepared to listen to the critics of vaccination, then guess what happens? Number one is that you lose an opportunity to try to persuade them that their ideas are either wrong or that if they do have some legitimate concerns, you fail to address them. That's one thing that happens. The other thing that happens is that they don't just say, oh, well, we're not allowed to talk about this. I guess we'll just move on to something else. They become increasingly radicalized. And so what happens is that they find alternative media sites and alternative forums, and then more and more bad information gets shared. So what is the point in radicalizing and polarizing people when, if you bring together alternative perspectives, you can hear what the nature of the concern is, you can address some of them, and you can develop better arguments if you're not being very persuasive? So I think there are very, very few issues that would fall into that category. The only ones that really do are the ones where somebody might suffer harm if you give a platform to a person who is advocating harm against a particular community. But those are pretty clearly defined in our hate speech codes, where it crosses the line into criminal code conduct. So it does seem to me that what we have right now is a hypersensitive generation that just doesn't want to be challenged by ideas they disagree with. And the university campus isn't the place for you if you're not prepared to develop your critical thinking skills and be prepared as well to hear challenging ideas and find a way to counter them. That's the whole purpose of what universities are about.
And right, and the other point that was being made as well is that demonstrations will still be allowed, obviously, on campus to those with opposing views.
Yeah, as it should be. And I hope that they don't get... Let's remember, though, what has happened is that the Antifa and Black Bloc movements, the extreme radicals, have come out when they have a speaker they don't like and created damage, burned things down, smashed windows. So there is also a limit as well on protest. You're not allowed to cause harm to the people who want to attend the events. You're not allowed to damage property and vandalize either. So all of these things are going to be have to be navigated. We're going to talk to the minister today to find out why he's giving the extra time. He does not want to come down with a heavy hand. When I spoke with him about this before, he doesn't want to go down the path of not, if universities don't comply, then there's going to start seeing their funding pulled back, which has been suggested in other jurisdictions. He thinks that he can work collaboratively so that every voice can be heard. And he's just given them a little bit more time to do it.
All right. Thanks so much, Danielle.
Yeah, my pleasure.